This video is to allow you to correct your homework for section 8.1.2, problems 820 through 829. There are five students of different ages. Their median age is 13 years. What are two possibilities for the ages of the three oldest students? So what we want to think about is if there's five students and the median is 13, that means the middle value when the numbers are in order has to be 13. So then you can create some possibilities based on that. So for example, you might say 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. That could be a possibility. You might say that everybody, well, since they said that they're different ages, you can't make them all 13, but you could say maybe the younger one is 9, and then 11, 13, and then maybe 16 and 17. So again, there's some different possibilities and you need to come up with at least two possibilities, preferably not necessarily the ones I just gave you. So here's some other possibilities. This is one I gave you. This is one that they have as well. If each student is a different age, how many have to be younger than 13? Well, based on what we've done, we see that there'll have to be two that are younger than 13, because if they're all gonna be different ages and 13's in the middle, two have to be less than that. And then describe what a median is to another student. Pretend that they were absent that day. In other words, how would you describe the concept of median? So you can put it in your own words, but something about the idea that median is the middle value when the numbers are in order. And if there's two numbers in the middle, you will average them, add them up and divide by two. So here they want you to look at the data set below and the statement made about it. They tell you that the statements are false. So without making calculations, how can you explain or justify that the statement would have to be false? So the set of 24, 25, 26, and 28 has a mean of 30. Well, you can tell just from looking at these numbers that if you added them up and divided by 4, which is how you find the mean, it's not going to be 30 because 30 is greater than any of these values. So again, you can put that in your own words. But basically, you cannot have a mean or average that's greater than all the values in the list. And then the 15 is the median of this data set. We can tell the mistake here is that the student or whoever chose the middle value, but the numbers were not in order. So again, if you're going to have a median, numbers have to be in order. Then you pick out the middle, and in that case, it'd be 14. Here you're simply comparing with greater than, less than, or equal to. So one way you can do this is to add a non-essential zero so you have the same number of decimal places. So 183 thousandths compared to 180 thousandths, this would be greater. If you think of a number line, negative 13 is greater than negative 17. Like think about temperature too. Negative 13 is cold, but it's warmer than negative 17. Here you could change 1/8 to a decimal. 1 divided by 8 actually is equal to 125 thousandths. Here, negative 6 is less than negative 4. Again, pictured on a number line or in terms of temperature. Here, we can tell 72% would have to be less than 35 thirtieths. And the reason we know that is because 72% is less than 100%, which is 1. And this is an improper fraction, so this is greater than 1. And then here might be a little bit tricky, but if we think of it as we've got 25 hundredths, which is negative, compared to 5 hundredths, which is negative, 25 hundredths, which is negative, is actually less than. And one way to think about that is, you know, if we were on the right side of the number line, in other words, if these are positive, this would be greater than this, but when they're negative, it's going to be the opposite. Find the area of the shape, show your steps. So there's a couple different ways you could do this. You could use the area of a trapezoid formula. Make sure you write down the formula and then what you're combining. So 21 and 25 hundredths would be the top base. And then 31 and 25 hundredths would be the bottom base. You'd add those up, get the total, then divide by 2, and then multiply by the perpendicular height of 7 6/10. That will give you this. Another way you could have approached it, and again, just make sure you show your work, is to do it as the area of a rectangle plus the area of a triangle. So find the area of the rectangle, show what you did, find the area of the triangle, and then combine them. Again, obviously the answer should be the same, but make sure you have your work shown. A school survey showed that 153 students owned Pi Pods. So instead of iPods, it's a math class, so Pi Pods. 53 students own Pi Phones, 17 own both, 246 own neither. What's the ratio of Pi Pod owners to Pi Phone owners? So basically, we know that 153 own the Pi Pods and 53 own the Pi Phones. So the ratio is just 153 to 53. Now, remember, you can write a ratio like this with a colon sign. You could write it as a fraction or with the word two between it, T-O. Also remember, if you could simplify it, you should do so, but this cannot be simplified. What's the ratio of Pi Phone owners to those that have neither a Pi Phone nor a Pi Pod? So this would be the 53 again, because that's the Pi Phone owner number, to the neither number, which is 246. And then what would be the best way to display this data? They want you to go back to the beginning of the book to think about different types of data displays. And Venn diagram would probably work best because you're going to have that overlap. Some students own both, and you're going to have some outside of the circles showing that they own neither. You could use a bar graph because the data is categorical and there's not an order to it. So that would be another way you could do it. The challenge, of course, is that the both, again, we want to make sure that it's clear that that's an area of overlap. 8:25, they're giving you this data. You have to find a create a histogram and use it to justify whether the mean or median is a better choice for a typical hummingbird's weight and calculate it. So when you're going to create a histogram, what we're going to do, remember, is start with a title. Then you're going to go with the hummingbird weights along the horizontal. And this is how many, or we sometimes say frequency, along the side. They should have put that. And then they went with going by basically ones. So this would be hummingbirds that are between 4 and 5 ounces. So basically 4 ounces would be in this category because 5 again picks up on the next bin. So you would not have had to go by ones. You could have gone by twos and said, I'm going to show 4 to 6, 6 to 8, 8 to 10, 10 to 12. That would be acceptable as well. But based on what they did, we have basically 1 in the 4 bin, 1 in the 5 bin, nothing for 6, 1 in the 7 bin, 2 in the 8 bin, that's right here, 4 in the 9 bin, in the 10 bin is 7, and in the 11 bin is 3. So again, you can see all of that. Then they want to know whether you should use mean or median for typical weight. Well, what you see when you do this histogram is that it's not symmetrical data. Remember, symmetrical data would be like where it's almost mirror images of each other, something like this, almost like a bell curve, where you go, okay, this is the halfway point, and, you know, this half looks the same as this half, that kind of thing. And that's not happening. So it's not a symmetrical set of data. So when you don't have symmetrical data with a histogram, you should usually use the median, right? And then they want to know what is the typical weight. So if you put these in order, which you should show that work, and pull out your middle value, it is 10. So again, make sure that you have all of this included, have the graph done well, and also show how you found the median. This person is correcting these math tests. Here's the scores for the first 14 tests. What score does not seem to fit in this set of data? In other words, which one is an outlier? And how will an outlier affect the mean and median? Well, hopefully it jumps out at you that the outlier is the 12. There's some low values, there's some high values, but 12 is much lower than everything else. So 12 is much lower than the rest of the data. It will make the class mean or average lower, but it won't make much difference on the median. And that's why we say that we will use the median for a typical value if we don't have symmetry or if we have an outlier, because it's not going to be impacted as much as the average would be or the mean. Here we've got two broken ruler segments. One goes from 2.5 to 5 inches. The other goes from 3.5 to 5.5 inches. Which one is longer? How much longer? So 2.5 to 5 inches would be a 2.5 inch ruler. 3.5 to 5.5 would be a 2 inch ruler. So the first one is longer, and it's longer by 1/2 inch. So again, put a little bit more work, or show a little bit more work than just this. Here you're going to rewrite them first using the distributive property. Then you're going to evaluate them if x is 2 and y is 5. So remember, when you see this setup, you're looking to pull out the greatest common factor from both terms. Well, the greatest common factor between 8x and 4 is 4. So 4 will go in front. 4 times what equals 8x? That would be 2, specifically 2x. The minus sign is going to be there. And then 4 times what equals 4? Well, that would be 1. So again, we call that factored form, or using the distributive property. Then if we know x is 2, we're basically going to either go back to this original, which is what I did, or you could go to this one. But either way, you're replacing x with 2. So I went and replaced x with 2 here, and then 8 times 2 minus 4 gave me 12. But if I replace x with 2 here, I'd get 4 minus 1 is 3. 4 times 3 is again 12. Should get the same answer, because these are just different formats of the same information. Here, greatest common factor would be 6 and y. What do we multiply 6y by to give us 6y to the second power? That would be, again, y, because 6 times y is 6y squared, plus, what do we multiply 6y by to give us 24y? That would be 4. And then we're going to replace y with 5. And again, you can do it in this version or in this version, whatever you think is easier, but show your work. All right, I went and showed it with this version. And then here, these two are the opposite in that they are already with parentheses, and we're going to write them without parentheses. So when we take 7x times y, we're going to get 7xy, then the minus sign, and then 7x times 2 is going to give us 14x. So this would be multiplied out using the distributive property. And again, replace your x with 2, your y with 5, show your work. I did that based on, let me just see what I did that based on. I did it based on the original again. We got 42, but again, it will work here too. And then here, 3 times 9 is 27, plus 3 times y is 3y. So again, that's multiplied out, and replace y with 5. Find the value. Here you're going to solve the generic rectangle puzzles and then put them in that order where it's the length times width equals the sum of the parts equals the area. So we could start with 7 times what equals 63? That would be 9. 9 times what equals 180? That would be 20. 20 times 40 is 800. 7 times 40 is 280. And then you're going to have 49 times 27 equals 800 plus 180 plus 280 plus 63 equals 1,323. Here, what times 500 is 15,000? That'd be 30. What times 30 is 90? That'd be 3. 9 times what is 720? That'd be 80. 30 times 80 is 2,400. 9 times 500 is 4,500. 9 times 3 is 27. Then 583 times 39 equals 15,000 plus 2,400 plus 90 plus 4,500 plus 720 plus 27, total of 22,737.